Among the most famous women to have lived, Cleopatra VII ruled Egypt for 22 years. She lost a kingdom once, regained it, nearly lost it again, amassed an empire, lost it all. A goddess as a child, a queen at 18, a celebrity soon thereafter, she was an object of speculation and veneration, gossip and legend even in her own time. At the height of her power, she controlled virtually the entire eastern Mediterranean coast, the last great kingdom of any Egyptian ruler. For a fleeting moment, she held the fate of the Western world in her hands. She had a child with a married man, three more with another. She died at 39, a generation before the birth of Christ. Catastrophe reliably cements a reputation, and Cleopatra's end was sudden and sensational. She's lodged herself in our imaginations ever since. Many people have spoken for her, including the greatest playwrights and poets. We've been putting words in her mouth for 2,000 years. In one of the busiest afterlives in history, she's gone on to become an asteroid, a video game, a cliché, a cigarette, a slot machine, a strip club, a synonym for Elizabeth Taylor. Shakespeare attested to Cleopatra's infinite variety. He had no idea. Alexandria's 90-foot-wide main avenue left visitors speechless, its scale unmatched in the ancient world. You could lose a day exploring it from end to end. Lined with delicately carved columns, silk awnings, and richly painted facades, the canopic way could accommodate 8 chariots driving abreast. The city's primary side streets, too, were nearly 20 feet wide, paved with stones, expertly drained, and partially lit at night. From its central crossroads, a 10-minute walk from the palace, a forest of sparkling limestone colonnades extended as far as the eye could see. On the city's western side lived most of its Egyptian population, many of them linen weavers, clustered around the 100 steps that led up to the Serapeum, the 3rd-century temple that dominated the city and housed its secondary library. That rectangular temple, much of it decorated in gold leaf, silver, and bronze, stood on a rocky artificial hill surrounded by parks and porticos. It is one of only 3 monuments of Cleopatra's day that we can locate with accuracy today. The city's Jewish quarter stood in the northeast next to the palace. Greeks occupied the fine 3-story houses at the center of town. Industry divided neighborhoods as well. One quarter was devoted to the manufacture of perfumes and to the fabrication of their alabaster pots, another to glass workers. From east to west, the city measured nearly 4 miles, a wonderland of baths, theaters, gymnasiums, courts, temples, shrines, and synagogues. A limestone wall surrounded its perimeter, punctuated by towers, patrolled at both ends by prostitutes. During the day, Alexandria echoed with the sounds of horses' hooves, the cries of porridge sellers or chickpea vendors, street performers, soothsayers, moneylenders. Its spice stands released exotic aromas, carried through the streets by a thick, salty sea breeze. Long-legged white and black ibises assembled at every intersection, foraging for crumbs, until well into the evening, when the vermilion sun plunged precipitously into the harbor. Alexandria remained a swirl of reds and yellows, a swelling kaleidoscope of music, chaos, and color. Altogether, it was a mood-altering city of extreme sensuality and high intellectualism, the Paris of the ancient world, superior in its ways, splendid in its luxuries, the place to go to spend your fortune, write your poetry, find or forget a romance, restore your health, reinvent yourself, or regroup after having conquered vast swaths of Italy, Spain, and Greece over the course of a Herculean decade.